Yeah, Eric's leading in with the song. Or more. Yeah, we could just kind of meditate. And Eric, maybe you can ease us into this great morning experience.
Yeah. We'll have three. You have two now. One is over there somewhere. Yeah. Vocals in my monitor. Mm-hmm. song playing silently everywhere. It's hard to hear if you're listening only with your ears. Can you see the light shining endlessly through your mind? It's hard to find if you're looking only with your eyes. Can you smile, smile that lightens up the world for a while? But don't try, by the love inside. Can you see that we're imprisoned only by our beliefs, and we are take my hand, rise together from this foreign land, and see that we never need to think no plan. We must only decide we'll be happy once we've made up. Walking faster only slows you down. Just be patient, keep your feet on the ground. Can you feel the love? It's all around to help you rise above all the pain and fear you've been dreaming of. It's all right to just let go and simply fall in love. Can you hear the song playing silently everywhere? It's right here, singing softly that there's nothing to fear.
Three mics going live. I need a little more volume on this one.
I'm gonna hand this mic over to Francis.
And there's supposed to be something. Is there one down there, you said, Eric? There's one down here. Okay. So we can kind of move this one around and move this. There's one down there for questions. Yeah. That's beautiful. And then is Sarah still here? You want to do something? She was ready to do something a few minutes ago, and then it's beautiful.
Kane, keeping with the non-personal intimacy, I'm just going to use first names. We've got Helena, Jackie, Kirsten. I'm going to forget everyone's names as I go through. The beautiful Suzanne, the beautiful Lisa, the wonderful David, the exciting Francis. Don't know where they're coming from. The intrepid Jason. The joyful Jenny. And the beloved Nikita. And then the empty space for returning.
Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Thank you. The devoted Sarah. Yeah, thank you. Wow, well, it's fun. We haven't ever done this. So it's kind of fun for us. It's always a first. Everything's brand new. And yeah, we're really big into transparency. So a lot of what this is about is just having us come up is just to be fully available. I know we're just having a ball meeting you in all these holy encounters, you know, throughout the week, but it's actually good. Sometimes there's curiosity and questioning, and it just is, I think it all serves the awakening, because if there are no private thoughts, if there's just love and everything else is grist for the mill, so to speak, letting everything just go to love and light, then that's been a core of what we've been all about. And when I was coming down here today, I was just thinking, just witnesses of devotion. Because nothing really, form matters at all, but the love and the devotion and that single-mindedness is precious. It doesn't have anything to do with time. It's not like, how many years have you done this, or basically a state of mind of what is in the present moment is not an achievement even. It doesn't even fit on the timeline. You know, there's a part in the workbook where Jesus is talking about this glorious state of mind, and he said, and you attained it not through learning. Isn't that interesting, coming from the author of a book that's called A Course, with a text and a workbook and a teacher's manual, and then he talks about this glorious state of mind, and he said, and you attained it not through learning. It's grace. You know, nobody's achieving anything. Nobody works at enlightenment and eventually gets there. There are no enlightened people. Buddha wasn't enlightened. Jesus wasn't enlightened. People, masks don't get enlightened. It's just one state of mind behind all these different faces and people. And that's probably, in the end, that can turn to be your biggest block of going for personal enlightenment, you know, and this whole deal of enlightened teachers and all this baloney. You know, eventually you start to see it comes down to an experience that is so glorious that it comes from a source, but it doesn't have a source in the world, so to speak. There's no form that is it. And we've been talking a lot this week. Lisa's been sharing about no thingness. We were talking in the hot tub this morning about the Addams Family. Did anyone ever see the Addams Family? And we were in the hot tub, and I said, remember thing. Just thing. Wasn't that a great character on a sitcom? Thing. And then there was it. Was it. Isn't that fun to have characters named Thing and It? You know, because it really fits with what we're talking about, you know, that it's so far beyond the personal. And yet, while you believe in the personal and you're opening your heart to this vast love, the words and the symbols can reach your heart in helpful ways. And that's really why we seem to be sitting up here, is because this is for the glory of God. There aren't really any personal questions. There aren't hard questions and easy questions. There aren't clever questions. There's really nothing but just beautiful, pure simplicity that's always just what is. The truth is simple. The present moment is simple. And it's really an honor to be with all of you. These characters that are sitting near me, and the characters that are there, and the characters that write books and get on the cover of Time magazine or seem to be famous or infamous, like Hitler and Mussolini, it's really, we're not going to find anything in the characters. They're just symbols, symbols that the Spirit can use to lift us into this experience of oneness. And in A Course in Miracles, it talks about specialness. And none of these characters here, and none of these characters in the world, or even the alien characters that seem to be in other realms, none of them are special. You're not going to find anything special in a person. You know, you can only find imagination in persons. You can only find, they're just symbols, but the symbols are representations. So you will never have an experience of finding something real in symbols, because symbols are representations. They are not actualities. And so that's what I love about it. And it's actually been fun living with this group. I mean, I kind of am all over the world, so I see this group every once in a while, or pretty rarely, actually. It's like you can't even call it a group. It's just a poor word for this. They're all over the planet, and yet there's a deep love and devotion and an honor. It's actually an honor. Presence feels honoring. Presence feels deep. Presence feels reverent. To me, presence is what devotion's all about. That's, to me, everything. Everything is in presence. And no thing, you could say it that way, no thingness or everythingness we've been talking about, that really is an honoring feeling. So actually, I think that's one of the things that all of us could easily talk about, is this honoring feeling. Like, it is an honor. And we're not talking about a group of people, but just the experience we have with all of you and all of the thousands and tens of thousands of people that we've actually met all over the planet. It is an honor. I was singing the other day to my friend Christian, a friend's a friend forever if the Lord's the Lord of them. And a friend will not say never, because the welcome will not end. That's what I was feeling, this honoring, like, wow, we are living in this honoring presence. So I thought today, first of all, I would just open it up with everybody here. This is a little choppy here.
Yeah, it looks like we're having some sort of a connection problem there. I don't know if it's the cable.
I'm jamming it in. I'm putting that thing in as tight as it goes. So. No, wait a minute. I think it's working. It was just twiggling around here. I'm making sure it's stuffed in there really good. I don't want you to miss a fraction of a second of this. It's in there. I'm jamming it in there good. So I thought what I would do is just kind of, let it come up spontaneously. If anyone here wants to share just about your life, about whatever the Spirit puts on your heart to share with all these beautiful, beloved ones. And that's really what we'll do. We're just going to share from our heart. And then, you know how it is with relationships, and some of you might have even lived in little communities, small communities. You know what happens. You know, it's the shit hits the fan. Whether it's relationships, or seems to multiply a bit when you get a group. You get a group this size, it's not really a group, but you know what I mean. It's, We've had some shit hit the fan over the years. I don't even remember how many years it's been. People say, we go on gatherings. Lisa and I were down in Arizona, Sedona, and somebody said, when did you meet and how long have you known each other? And we just get these blank looks like
are you still here?
Are you still here? We're like, but that's the thing with this group. If people ask me historical questions, like, when did you meet? Everybody's got their memories of things, and some of our memories are going pretty fast. I think this group is on a scale of 1 to 10 of spiritual dementia or spiritual Alzheimer's. We're kind of ringing the bell a lot, which is quite fun. We actually have a lot of laughter because we can't recall things. Functions that we used to be really good at start to leave. We're getting quite dysfunctional, actually.
<We're>
You know, they say, oh, I came from a dysfunctional family, and I say, oh, I'm going into a very dysfunctional. I think my family seemed more functional in the world. This is really dysfunctional. And the more you get to know us, you know. And they say, do you have any, like themes or anthems, real reverent themes to mention? I said, no, I think of the Monkees song, though. Hey, hey, we're the Monkees. People say we monkey around. We're too busy living to put anybody down. We don't. We really don't put people down. We've got enough shit hitting the fan to deal with. To nobody else. We're not putting anybody else in the world down. It's tough enough. Dealing with it. Sometimes it doesn't stop.
It continues to blow me away.
I was trying to give her the mic, but it's no. Not yet. So anyway, that's all I'm going to say for now. But anybody who would like to share from their heart, just whatever's on your heart, just about this life of devotion.
Oh. Oh. Yeah, I just feel so honored. Yeah. And it's not about any form, it's about an experience. It's about, you know, that God is real and love is real, and this commitment that I know that we all came together for was to actually experience. We trusted God. It wasn't trusting people. It was trusting God and walking through tons of fear and doubts and unworthiness and shame. And not really knowing what we were getting into when I met you. God, if I would have ever known that, I would have gone the other way, for sure. That's so true. Where the hell did you come from?
Did you have a life?
No kidding. Well, no, but I actually remember, this is the God's truth. I was studying a course and I was just having all these miracles and I was so in love with God and I was so, just all these miracles were happening and I just kept praying. I had a God room in my house and I just kept praying for a mighty companion to show up. And I mean, actually, it was probably my last prayer so deeply. Was I was saying, God, I want a mighty companion. I can't do this. I need a mighty companion. And look who showed up. Look at the hell out of here. I mean, literally, I thought he was a schizophrenic. When I met David, no one else was around. And so I'm like, you know, are you for real? And yeah, just this intense love, this love that I've never experienced before, and it actually wasn't sexual in nature at all, but just this love of God.
that I, yeah. Yeah, just I feel very speechless because there's been so much for me. And I feel like for me, just sitting here right now really isn't about David, really isn't about any of this. It's about my trust in God, and that, you know, all I ever wanted to know was that I wasn't separate from God, that I was one with God. And I now feel that. Completely. I am sitting here in an actual realization of that. I'm not just speaking about it. I'm not just talking words. I got exactly what I came for. I got, God honored my promise and my devotion to let go and to forgive and to continually join and to trust. And I know I got exactly what I wanted, and I'm happy, and I feel like anything. I know I'm one with God now, and I got everything, and there's nothing else that to experience, and it's the happiest experience because I'm no longer afraid. I'm no longer alone and separate, and so I say thank you to every one of us. This is what we came together for the holy relationship, to actually not just talk about it, but to also heal the specialness. We've healed a lot of specialness. It wasn't just all of us coming in knowing what we were doing, because actually I know now I know absolutely nothing what I'm doing, for real. And that is my safety. And I just feel very, very honored just to be sitting here sharing the good news and to share with you that God is real and love is real and everything else is illusion. And I am very glorified to demonstrate that for the rest of my experience here. And that's all I have to say. He held my hand tight, but we all held each other's hand really tight. So yeah, okay, go. Go.
I feel it's an honor. It's an honor to be in the presence of the Lord. It's an honor to be vast spirit in love and not in a group. I'm not in a group. And it's just, it's an honor to meet myself and just to be presence, and to follow along with what seems to be happening, which is an experience that is more and more perfect. It's a rest. It's just a beingness. Yeah. And a joy. I feel often, I just feel like Spirit is saying through me, I am available. And that's it. And there are answers. And yeah, everything is answered, and Spirit is saying, I'm available to answer things for others too. Because nothing is hidden, nothing is obscure in reality, in the gift that is given us. Like, Spirit and truth is not obscure, so yeah, anything can be answered. anything that is a question or a pain or confusion or being lost or anything. So I am available. And I could share a lot about the past and the messengers and meeting David, and it's, but I don't think I want to. It's been beautiful gifts and perfect gifts and some hardships, actually, but it was all the past and it was all gracefully given for healing and purification and to be led to the non-personal. So I just say thank you, God. Thank you, everything. Thank you for all of you and everyone in the world. Everything. I am available.
I don't know if I have much words. I feel like I don't have much to say at all, but I'm just wondering, how do I extend this feeling of complete gratitude? Like complete full gratitude for everything that happened. I had this really amazing experience last night that it's hard to explain because it's beyond words. It's just hard. It's like the words just don't do it anymore. Really don't do it. And I was just looking at, I wasn't even looking, it just came up. For the past 2 years, just how ever since I came here, and it's been like I've been here with Living Miracles for 2 years, I just really saw again, like there's been, of course, we're doing forgiveness and there's been lots of washing away. And I just felt last night that everything just disappeared. There was nothing but gratitude. And I really saw how this was my direct path home that I asked for. That I prayed for, and everything that happened, every little thing, there's not one thing that I thought, I have it in my heart that I wish that was different. I wish that, you know, I could have done something different. It's like literally everything that was given, that was a very direct path home, like without any delays. And because I was just really amazed with gratitude for it. And it's like, I've always had it, but it was just like, there's not one, I saw in my mind, there's not one dark dot. It's like, oh, I feel gratitude, but yeah, there's a little, like, it happened at some point, you know, some kind of little grievance. There's everything was just, I felt everything just disappeared into this white light, and there was nothing but this deep gratitude. And it was like, how direct. I call it Argo, right? It was like, I call it Argo. This direct path, I call it Argo. I call myself Argo now. But that's a different, those who know me, they know. Yeah, those who know me, they know what I mean. And I just saw, like, just how yeah, the depth of it. And it's, and I felt like in the past few days, because, you know, because it was so direct, because the call of the heart was so direct and wanting to, like, okay, I don't want to waste time. I don't want to delay. I'm not looking for a feel-good experience nowhere near my heart. I'm not looking to camp out in the world and have some kind of experiences. I'm going for the ultimate experience. And it's like, spirit, give me the way. And so, of course, when there's that, when the call of the heart is so direct, and I was like, of course it was intense. It's like, because it was so, it was like, okay, done. It's like, of course the ego was, you know, like the part of that had to let go of, it was freaking out. There's, I'm like, but then I don't even remember that. It was just kind of like, these were the thoughts. And yeah, and it was like, because I had this, you know, kind of like there's this thought, like intensity, like this intense, and how, and what is gentleness and what's intense. And it was like, I really, again, it, like in the past couple of weeks, I just really saw spirit, like really show, reliving with me certain parts, like in the, like certain, like looking at certain parts of my journey. And it was just like, and really retranslating it and saying, like, you know, I was there, this was actually gentle, this is gentleness, although it was like so fast and direct and quick. It was like, and I was like, oh my god, you were, I really had that feeling. It's like, that was gentle, this is gentleness, like this is like real gentleness. And it like showed me how I was always with you, like even when I thought even when you felt that you were alone, I was always there, because it's like I was orchestrating the next step for you. And it was like, there's nothing, like I had this thought before somewhere that God is too busy or something, and it's unconscious, it's not personal. And I know I've come upon that 2 years ago or something. God's too busy. It's almost, and all of a sudden it just came in, and all I kept hearing is like, I have no goals but you. It's like, I have nothing else. There's literally no other priorities but you. You are my love. You are my goal. And that's what I kept hearing. And it was like, and somehow it tied in with Argo. And I saw that in the movie Argo. And it was deep. I was like, I've never seen that before. So, so I love this. I love it. Like, I love this path. I call it Argo. But it's abstract. It's actually very abstract. Why? So why? Because it's very undefined, and yet because it's like there's no there's nothing to cling to, and yet everything is given. And it's like you, like there's just really with this kind of path that is given, there's, it's just ego has no safety net, and so you just, you know, you go. And you just trust you're going to end up where you truly want to end up. And then that's the only thing. And so I'm very, I just wanted to relate that gratitude. And it's just been, it's been amazing. Yeah. And the tightness, like the relationship with spirit. I was just like, I felt it so strong. Just how this, I don't know, the depth, the linking up, and everything is just as a reflection of that deep linking up with spirit. And then I discovered, like, now I feel there's even a deeper invitation within my heart that I can totally feel to, you know, to link with spirit even closer on a much deeper level. And I was like, what? And I'm like, help me accept it. That's a yes. Just help me. What an honor. Again, like, what an honor. What an honor. Like, there isn't anything else. There isn't. What else would you want? What, like, I don't want anything else. So, yeah. Thank you.
Like, like Nikita, I don't feel I have a lot of words, but I just to speak from my heart, it feels as though to be with this group of people is the deepest, greatest honor that I could ever I wasn't sure whether I was even going to be able to speak because I've had waves of gratitude over the last 2 days that are so deep. It would be rather strange to think that we're a group of perfect people. We're not. And that's the support that we get from each other to actually wash the concept that that's where we're going. We're not about a better world or a better person, about improving anything about this. It's certainly not that, and that's the deepest realization, and that's the core of actually stepping fully into truth, into the truth of what we offer each other. And that was the gift for me, to actually stop efforting in the world, stop efforting. And each time something like that comes up now, like there's a self-concept that just seems to hook the mind, there's this crash, because there's such an awareness now that that's the false. That really is going to bring me crashing back to some place of illusion that I can't maintain, that as a true self that has a greater awareness of something more, this idea that there's still something here to be done is what hooks the mind back in. And it needs to keep being washed. That's why we're together. We support each other in that. And right behind releasing that, releasing any idea that there's anything here that can be done or that there's any control over any of it, has been such a deep letting go. Like, first of all, we let go control of our worldly lives. And as a group of people, that's just the pathway that seems to be taken, that we give up and really deeply look at the attachment to any of that. And that's a very deep step to take initially. Like, where are these attachments that I believe are going to keep me safe? And to release those from the mind. And life just seems to look how it is. It doesn't look perfect. We keep washing it. And then right behind releasing those attachments, there is such a deep devotion that's felt. It was always there, and we always have it. And that's when I meet you, I meet myself, because I know that's the devotion of everyone's heart. We all want to go home. We all want this. And that's what has me feeling overwhelmed with the absolute love and gratitude for the support that we give each other, that we come together in here, and that we can truly extend from our hearts. It's so vast. And Lisa, in one of her talks, talked about, she said most people seem to flip-flop. Yeah, I flip-flop. It's not a consistent experience. Like, I mean, while you're there, it feels very everything, overpowering, certainly as though it could never be lost. But a thought seems to have the mind crashing back into some belief, a false belief, and it just needs raising up again, joining with these devoted beings that I've been given. And there is so much love. and so much gratitude and so much honoring of this path. It deserves total support in every way. I can't go, I can't do any more now. Just go.
Yeah, for me, I didn't have a goal of spiritual enlightenment or awakening when I first started on what I later realized was a spiritual journey. I just wanted to go home, and I couldn't find that in the world, and I wanted to experience a kind of love that could never come to an end. And even though I seemed to have a pretty good kind of dream life, great family, Jackie was my mother. and a job I loved, and New Zealand, you know, the country that everyone thinks, you know, that would be the greatest country to live in. I couldn't get all the pieces together in such a way that I would be consistently happy. And it was just being led with that prayer of the heart, like, show me. And what unfolded was a devastation, which led to just permission, actually, to stop. Like an accident where I couldn't maintain my life anymore. And that was the beginning of really praying for help. Like really turning to a source that I didn't even know was there. But there was something so deep in me that was praying that I just had this revelatory experience of such deep love that just poured through my whole being. And it was so intense, like a you can't even call it love. I knew it was love, but it was so, so strong. That was it. In that moment, it was done. My life was given over to that. It was like, okay, there is something to pray to. There is a source that I can give my life over to. And in that moment, it just became about following really what was given and saying yes. And the yes ended up looking like this. It's totally unplanned. I had no idea where it would take me or what it would look like. And that is actually how we all live. Like, we don't plan our lives out in form. There isn't a plan of awakening that we didn't plan to all live in spiritual community. We didn't plan to have a monastery. We didn't plan to build anything. And the whole way along, it's just this: say yes, to what's given by the Spirit, and then dare to stay with it, actually. Because in the world, you can kind of choose, you know, who your friends are and who you spend time with. You can even choose how much time to spend with family or when to leave a job or, you know, when you're done with something. But with this kind of a path, with this kind of a devotion, we've said yes to the Spirit's plan. And then what comes is for our awakening. And that means it's for undoing the ego. And so it's going to be like undoing a self that was thought it was in control, and there's going to be fear that comes up, and, you know, projection that comes up, but because it's been given by Spirit, and there's this very deep commitment to trust in the purpose behind everything, we don't walk away from each other. And that's why we have experienced and continue to experience a deepening, like a deepening, a transformation of consciousness, because nothing's being avoided, nothing's being pushed away. It's more, okay, bring it on. What is it? Show me. Dare to stay with it. Dare to be humble. And the trust it takes to do that is, you know, that's where, like, trust and devotion to me are the same thing. Trust and devotion. And, yeah, it is going beyond trust in people. But the spirit uses the people to develop the trust. And so these ones that have been given are the ones that, yeah, there's this been this practice of development of trust with. Trusting the spirit's going to come through, you know, come through the channel that is most open in the moment when fear is there. Because when fear is there, then you can't hear the spirit. You know, fear blocks love. And so we turn to the support that's been available through each other and through the different contexts that are given to follow and experience, like really truly experience that there is one source guiding us. And it just ends up very telepathic, like when so much fear and resistance to hearing the spirit has been washed to the point where we just end up hearing, like really tuning into the same voice all the time. And that's like a big part of how we use each other for awakening. Is we're either feeling the same thing and we're happy and we're like, yeah, we hear it, we feel it, or we don't. And so that's a point of joining, and there's something to be seen, or something to be accepted, something to be washed, and that's what it's for. Like that's the point. It's to keep coming together, to just keep washing away the experience that there's something between us. Because the flow of life, like, is talked about quite a lot, and when I hear those words, I see things in pictures in my mind, and so it's capital letters, capital F, little O, capital L. It's just how it looks. And flow of life, like that's the one source, that's the spirit, that's God. And we know it when we're in that experience. Like that's the whole goal of every spiritual path, is to truly be in that flow of life. And yeah, and it's so glorious when we're in it. And when we're not, like when there's something that seems to be bumping up against it, or there's fear in the mind, then yeah, we're just here to say, okay, what is there to look at? And it's so deep. You don't even know, like, the depth of the unconscious mind that's there, like the depth of the, fear of love, the fear of giving over personal control to be completely surrendered to the flow of life. I don't mean just like a personal experience of, you know, you're just kind of flowing and accepting everything that's happening all the time as a person still in the world. Because, you know, a person with money could seem to be doing that. I can just like go where I want and do whatever I want. I'm talking about like when you're so surrendered over to the spirit that you're being carried by grace and there is nothing else. There's nothing but that experience. and the whole universe is just supporting. So yeah, it takes a lot of seeing what is not the flow of life and being just very, very transparent about that and not hiding. And yeah, that's what I feel like this community has really been for. And of course, the form shifts and changes. Sometimes we send out 2x2, you know, to go for a year somewhere, or sometimes we don't see each other. There was a period, I think, some of us hadn't seen each other for about 3 years. So it's very much not about, like, dependence on people. It's very much about that being guided of who you're to be with and where you're to go. And it's to seem to go through so many changes and transitions that in the end, ultimately, you experience that flow of life is who you are. And change is no longer frightening. Like, you go through change after change after change to the point where you can't experience change anymore because it's just who you are, and the scenery changes. But that God goes with me everywhere I go gets so solid that it's just a presence that cannot be lost. Thank you.
It's very telepathic. I said, if she stops now, I'll speak. She said, thank you. Okay. Yeah, it's really cool. What's coming to me is, like, somebody asked the other day, you know, what is this community? And the one word that came to my mind was guidance. And I, for me, that's been the greatest gift about being here. Even in the end, guidance dissolves too. But I'd just like to talk about that a little bit because it's so powerful. Like, we're so radical, actually, that we undo the idea of personal inspiration. And I have seen that is one of the most difficult and radical things to undo, because we come from such a repressed culture and about, you know, stuff your emotions, don't say this, don't whatever. That you, when you get into this idea of following your heart, following your inspiration, it sounds so great. And it is. It's like, you know, don't people please. Don't do what others tell you to do. Break free of society. You know, even the anarchists have got their positives. Like, you know, just break free of the mold. And that was kind of like, I grew up in this conspiracy theory family. And the greatest thing I took out of it was that don't believe everything you're told. And so personal inspiration sounds good. And then when you really go deeper into this, and you start to accept, like, at least intellectually, the idea is, like, there's only one mind. Well, where does the idea of a personal or a separate inspiration fit into there's only one mind? It doesn't make sense. And I love it when this happens. But it's like, that's where we've joined together, because we're willing to say that there's no personal inspirations. And there's one inspiration. And if we tune in together, this can be a fast track to awakening, because we can speed up the discontinuities of the ego, meaning where it wants to take you off on these tangents that can seem like so exciting and so inspiring, and maybe, but, you know, they might take you off a cliff. Like, I grew up in this place called near Head Smashed in Buffalo Jump, where, like, it was like this giant native place. I was going through it, and, like, they had all these hundreds and thousands of buffaloes, and if you could just get the lead buffalo to run off of this cliff, everybody else, not else, yeah, buffaloes, would follow off, and so they called it Head Smashed in Buffalo. I don't know where I'm going with that. And so that to me has been the greatest blessing, and it's taken a lot of trust, again, not in persons, but almost in the plan, and like Kirsten was saying, a yes. You know, to really trust that none of this has been a mistake, you know, that I'm here because it's part of a plan, not a special plan, but a plan for me, so to speak. And that's, I think, the gift I feel to extend, is that there's a plan towards the planless, you know. There's a plan towards the planless, and the experience of the planless, you know, it's what Lisa Cairns is talking about, and David in the direct message. But yeah, I mean, I have this funny story. Like, David and I were like, I don't know, 100 yards from each other, walking over this bridge in Cincinnati. Lisa was out there doing her interviewing all these people with her fake microphone that was tied into her back pocket. This Lisa here. She's like going around interviewing. You watch people kind of get into the whole thing with like, oh, I'm on camera, you know, what do you got to say? But it really pulls out this kind of a presence. Nothing's being recorded, of course. But
just pretending with a microphone.
And we're having all these holy encounters about eyes and true vision and true sight. Like Eric's song was about, you know, can you hear, can you see without the eyes? And that's everything that we're doing, is can you, you know, really feel? And I remember looking around one time, and I think David or one of us said, do you feel what I feel, Jason? Or do you feel what I feel, David? We're a few feet apart, and we look over and like, yeah, I feel it. And there's like a Hooters bar down by the down by the corner. There was like five of us. And it's like, okay, you got to let go of all judgments. You don't know what anything's for. And we're all guided to go into this Hooters bar. And we end up having this amazing encounter with this woman who was kind of trapped in the whole feel, whatever Hooters bars do. You know, like, I guess there's a culture or something. But, and it was just like this beautiful holy encounter. And it's telepathic, you know, everybody hears it. And you have to go past all spiritual judgments.
The temple?
Yeah, they're all the same. Monastery. So, yeah, I guess that's what I really wanted to share. And thank you. And I really feel the equality in all of that, because we're all joined in that. So, thank you.
Add a little bit to that, because I was there then too, that day, and we're used wherever we go, we are used by the spirit, and we were used for this woman who was going through something really deep, and it's like the perfect timing. That's like the experience of the miracle that we have. We're always at the perfect place at the perfect time, and we have the experience of being used or done through, because we have, you know, we have cleansed away a lot of layers, so spirit, this is an experience of being used by the spirit. So just want to share that, to that story. It was a fun day. It was a woman we met, she had actually no pupils in her eyes, and she could still see. And we had all those amazing miracles.
Thank you for sharing, Jason. You were singing Follow the Heart. And I am on the Follow the Heart tour. And to me, the heart is representing God. And that's the true heart. And when we fully surrender to that of not knowing anything, and just allow him to lead, that's our safety. This whole tour has unfolded in a way that is just amazing, of just watching him guiding and leading. I heard Phoenix in the beginning of the tour, and then I joined with Laverne, and she said Kelly lives in Phoenix, and I had met Kelly once at Camas, and I know several of you have met with Kelly, and we drove towards Phoenix, and we came through this town that had a big mountain with a huge K on it, a white K, as if the name K came into mind, actually a K who is sitting here. And it was green lights of the road. What do you say, the stop, like the green, yellow, red? The traffic lights, it went green, and we took a photo of it. We sent it to Kay and called her straight away. And she said, Helena, I have felt your name, Helena. And I felt, for some reason, Grand Canyon. We're driving through Grand Canyon, right? And then she says, and I felt Phoenix. And she says, I have no clue why I felt these three things, but that's what I've heard. And when we surrender to that collaboration with the whole universe and just know that he leads the way, that we just have absolutely no clue about anything other. That's it. And I feel the gratitude of having connected with David and messengers throughout the years and just practicing this of listening and trusting and doing things that feels like it's turning in the stomach 50 times around and just keep at it and watch the miracles unfold. Because the guidance is washing away the ego, so when we learn to not buy into that, but just follow and follow and follow, that's how it looks like. This wash. This wash of everything that we thought we were or that we wanted. And just come to complete emptiness. Where we really don't have to do anything. So I came to this festival, I didn't even know if I would be singing. Or I heard it the day before and I bought the ticket straight away, and that's why I'm here. I'm so grateful to be here and meeting all of you and everyone. Thank you.
Suzanne or
Yeah, we talked quite a bit about devotion And, you know, the devotion of the heart is actually, for me, the devotion is the devotion to this. And the choice of should I be here or shouldn't I be here, is this it, or whether there is something else, they only exist in the mind. They're really a saying that, not this, I would rather stay in my mind. I'm thinking about the choice, you know, not this. And I know that, you know, the Course talks a lot about self-concepts. And it's not really like I have an attachment to any specific self-concept, like I'm a shy person, but there is this attachment to the self-concept. And it doesn't really matter what, there is addiction to define the self in any situation. So it's like the spirit is constantly guiding us to let go of the self-concept. Really is just to revealing the addiction there and attachment. And it's not like, I just feel like it's not even that I have to let go of specific self-concepts, but it's just revealing that there is a holding on to the self-concept. When I saw that, as a representation or as a symbol that I am addicted to the self-concept, I used to define myself as a spiritual seeker. And I actually really realized that it's not like I want to merge with which God or with oneness. It's like I was actively holding on to something that is separate. And it's just revealing in different situations. But this spiritual seeker concept, when I saw it, I was just thinking how humbling that was, that I was actually actively holding on to something. And from that point, the focus wasn't really how to let go of it, but more like how did I actively holding on to it in every moment? How did I maintain it? And this group, if, you know, a teacher is a true teacher, not through talking about it or even, it's like this given context is actually actively telling me where I was actively maintaining it and when and how. And that's really, and even just by looking at it, that's all that needs to be done. There is no other thing to be done. So there is a very deep devotion because what is given, we say the word a lot, given, but meaning what is here and now, it's not being resisted anymore. We know the purpose of it. The purpose of it is not for us to imagine in mind, is this it? Is this what I want? And should I go somewhere else? But it's like, hey, see what is going on. See what is happening, you know. And that is the devotion, the purpose. And the dedication, the mind does not waver. It doesn't really, it's not like we don't do different things, but the mind is still. It's not this or that, this or that. It's like.
These mannerisms now.
So, yeah, so I just want to say that it's just so delightful because of this single purpose that everybody is sharing and then coming together is just so simple. There is no mix of purpose. Even you know, if there is some kind of protection going on, it's always a protection of self-concept, and we can just express, and then we drop into this stillness again together. It just feels like, you know, this is given.
That's the word.
I'll do my best. I keep having a flashback to 1997. It's all simultaneous, but just sitting over here under this tree and having such a deep desire to heal my mind, but not even knowing what that meant. And so as the spirit would have it, I was taken out of my life and brought out here, and which is this one desire, which was to find that deep connection. And so people would say to me, oh, give her 6 months. She's not going to last out there. But I had such a deep desire for this connection. And I kept hearing, you have to come out here and heal your mind. And I didn't have any idea what that meant. And I'm not going to go into the whole story because I'm no longer interested in it, but just these waves of like knowing now that I'm carried by an unseen, invisible force that I've always felt drawn to, but I always tried to hang on to the world and have it. And so this was one of the major steps when I came out here, was to listen to that voice. Not even knowing what it meant. And so sitting here, I don't know how many years ago that was, but here we are almost in the exact same spot. And here I am. And it's like, just following and trusting, not having any idea of what I was doing. Just that devotion. I love that word, devotion. It's my favorite word, because that's what we're all connected in, is that deep devotion of the heart. It's where we're connected. And these particular ones were given at a certain period of time, because I kept hearing after several years out here, I had to go deeper. Again, not knowing what that meant. I'd studied the course for years. I did the best I could. But then I think all the tears are that where Jesus says in the Course that mighty companions will be given when you really make up your mind to serve one purpose, let thine eye be single to the glory of God. And it's like, I knew that that's all I wanted. And then David and Messenger showed up. And when I sit with them like this and I just look, you know, glance, it's like I just have these waves of like knowing, just knowing that we're given exactly what we need. And these are the particular ones that we're given. I certainly wouldn't have chosen to live in community. I lived out here by myself for a while, and you know, it was the last thing I think any of us really wanted to do. But but when you give up your plan, and I could see I had a plan for my awakening. I actually thought I could sit by the river and just meditate and get past the thoughts and wake up. And maybe some can do that. But what I didn't know is that I had to come into this community, come into being with these people to get in touch with this deep self-hatred. That in my life, I couldn't see it. I didn't even know it was there. And Jesus talks about the unconscious mind. My life was so good, seemingly, in the world, that it was so pushed out of awareness. I tell people, I had to come into this community to get into my unhappiness. I had to face
things that I didn't even know were there. And how do you do that? I mean, it's like if I like somebody just said, if they would have known what was going to happen, they would have run the other way. I certainly would have. And, you know, I don't want to paint a bleak picture because I actually thought I was giving up a life. I actually believed I was giving up something. And it has been arduous, and it has been painful, and it has been all of that stuff. To look at all of what I was giving up and to see that I was giving up absolutely nothing. That I am it. And it can't be explained. But I know this, that I had a devotion. I had a calling in my heart. I knew something was not right with this world, even though everything, according to world standards, was pretty damn good. And so to just sit here in this, just this backdrop with all of us together and knowing that we all have that, that we are that connection, that we are that, that we are the blessing, that it's so worth it, whatever it takes. And you don't know it until you start to let go of it, how much effort it takes to be a person, how much effort it takes to hold up that mask. So I am grateful for my mighty companions, because when I couldn't see for myself, they would reflect my innocence. When I hated myself so deeply, and we never even used the word hate in our home. It was just like, it wasn't allowed. And I didn't ever really experience it. But when I started to face that intense darkness, I would have these faces telling me it's not true. It's not true. And then just to let it roll through. Just let it all roll through. It's just passing through. It's just passing through. So wherever the devotion is, there I am. That's how I feel. Wherever the devotion calls, I answer. And all of the emotion is just this intense gratitude. Like sometimes I just feel like I'm going to explode. To just know that this is holy ground, this is sacred ground, where we join in the mind. That's the intimacy. To allow each other to see all those things that we don't even know are there. Until you start unwinding the mind. A good book. Anyway, thank you. I didn't know that I would even be able to share it. It's just so profound, the experience. And that you each of you are a blessing to the mind. And I'm so grateful that you're here. It's like every time we have a retreat, I always feel like everybody that comes here just blesses, you know, just blesses my mind and expands my mind. It doesn't even matter if I've talked to you or not. I feel it. So thank you.
Well, we're Jenny. They'll ask you lots of questions, Jenny. Jenny's like, well, actually, I just wanted to say that when you were saying getting in touch with your unhappiness, getting in touch with hatred, getting in touch, you know, a lot of times people think of spirituality or spiritual journey as like be happy, and you know, you can't consistently be happy until you get in touch with what's unhappy. You know, we go through the darkness to the light. And it's so beautiful that's the love and the devotion. It's really, maybe these will say that they were drawn to happiness, but then they had to face a lot of unhappiness in order to flip around into the happiness. And so in that sense, it's very practical. You know, not everyone knew, no one knew what they were getting into. No one knows, has an idea of how deep the rabbit hole goes. Or even sometimes that there is a rabbit hole. It's like, I want to be happy. Can I join? what's a rabbit hole? You know, I have no, they just join in, join the be happy group, you know. And some of you, but maybe that's part of it. When we even use the word join, like some people are saying like, well, can I join your community or can I be a part of it and this and this and this. You know, really, spirit is not so much interested in bodies joining bodies or bodies leaving bodies and all that. It really just doesn't amount to anything, really. But this idea of joining, sometimes people will say, what will it take? Are there pragmatic steps? How do you guys do finances, for example? How do you guys, this is your opportunity today, you know, if you want to ask any questions. Like if you could ask the Essenes how they live or the Franciscans or whatever. You can ask the questions, but to us, money is like a neutral symbol. It's not, it doesn't have a meaning. It doesn't have a value. It seems to be really practical in terms of what the world calls horizontal daily living, but it's just a symbol. And when your mind gives it over to be, you might say, just stewarded by the spirit, it's the same as with bodies. It's the same with properties, cars, everything. When you get into this grace, when you're in the flow of grace, then those things, everything's so perfectly taken care of that you don't give any thought to it. You know, you don't have a concern around it. It's so different from the world where things like the money and the body are so raised up and so important. They just fade and fade and fade and fade from awareness. Imagine going through a day where you don't think of money at all. You know, it's a fun day. You can really be happy, joyous, and free. But while you still have connotations and meaning and interpretations around it, then words like scarcity and lack and funds and so on and so forth, it's really being in the gratitude so fully that everything else just fades from awareness. So it's actually fun. I think you'll have a fun time asking some questions or sharing your comments today because we're having a fun interaction with, you might say, with the spirit. The spirit is playful. The spirit is joyful. Even when there seems to be like things called guidelines, they aren't really serious, and they're just there. I was having a talk with Marissa, and she was talking about boundaries. Like there's all this love, 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 and then, whoa, I think I need a few boundaries here. There's so much love, and whoa. And I was saying, yeah, that's like getting in touch with your intuition. You know, that's what boundaries are. They aren't like real limits. It's just like touching the spirit inside of you and say, what's helpful here? You know, if you have love, 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 and then all of a sudden people are coming up to you with sexual attractions and this, or can you help me with this? Can you do this for me? Can you promise me this? Can you commit to this? And blah, blah, blah. You know, just go into your intuition. Say, what feels helpful right now? Is there something that feels helpful? And the spirit is so right there, so available, like Jenny said, to give you in that moment, in this moment, whatever is helpful. There's a prayer in A Course in Miracles that says, I am here only to be truly helpful. Wow. When you go into that truly helpful, wow, that's a trip. As you go in deeper and deeper into that, you go into humbleness, you go into transparency, you go into trust, deep faith. It just takes you, that one prayer takes you so, 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 so deep into who you really are. And when people say, well, how do you solve problems? What's your decision-making capacity? How do you govern yourselves? How, you know, all the typical questions with communities and groups that have been asked for centuries and centuries. Those are practical questions. We would say prayer, really. I think if you went through it, how do you deal with the day-to-day issues and things that come up, pray first, you know, instead of reacting and responding and jumping in there to try to analyze or figure out, pray first. Ask. Go to your intuition. So it's just such an honor to be with you, and I just thank you all for sharing what you all shared. It was very, very profound, and I do want to, you know, open it up. And we have a roving mic. Yeah, we've got a little over half an hour here, so I want to open it up to everyone and share. Jenny, do you have something more to share?
Give me quick. Just like to share how great it is that spirit comes through everywhere. And when Helena talked about Kay and the miracles, and was thinking I shouldn't take the mic one more time because I took it twice, so I didn't take it after that. But then when Suzanne said, unwind your mind at the end, I was like, okay. Because I have been, I've never been a singer or anything, but I felt with Pete, like Spirit said, sing with Pete, sing unwind your mind with Pete. And it was planned for one of the evenings, and I was kind of doubtful about doing it. And it didn't even happen that evening because probably some doubt thought. But anyway, it happened the morning after. Anyway, every time Kay shows up, she says something about unwind your mind to me without even thinking about it. She's like, oh, unwind your mind. Like she asks something or says something. And it's just really cool because I think Spirit is like, yeah, you need to accept that you can be used for singing too. Like, you know. So I just have to share that. I think it's really beautiful how it comes through so innocently without even the messenger knowing why, you know. So.
I just wanted to comment. I hope I don't get feedback from that because I'm too close to the speaker. I just wanted to comment on my impression of, I guess it's 10 of you. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. Whatever the number is. Whatever the number is. That you are collectively showing me you're an example of living the happy dream. The Course talks about living the happy dream. In the awakening, well, I'm just preaching to the choir here, but, you know, in the process of awakening, we are not awakened suddenly from this dream. We're not shaken from this nightmare that we're living, but rather we are awakened gently, and our dreams become a happy dream. And you all seem through your devotion to living the Course, the principles of the Course, you seem to be living the happy dream. That's all I want to share.
This vacation from the world is my vocation, and I'm just don't want the cast to come off before the bone's healed, you know?
He said, this vacation is my vocation, and I don't want the cast to come off before the bones are healed. I think that means he doesn't want to leave.
We love you, Steve. I love that. I never heard that. Don't want to take the cast off till the bones have healed. Yeah, that inner, until I've had a catharsis, till I've really felt that experience. That cast will be right there supporting you. That's kind of using a movie metaphor. Here's the cast. Look at your cast. You've got a beautiful cast here. Loving you and supporting you. Yes.
That reminds me of
you know, being in community and living with messengers has been the scaffolding. It's been the cast, you know. And it hasn't been too long ago where we feel like the scaffolding can start to come down now. You know, we kind of joke around messengers, the title Messengers of Peace. When we all came together, we were anything but that. We were anything but peaceful. And yet it was used as somewhat of a cast or a cocoon or the scaffolding so that we could just drop deeper and deeper into that brokenness, so to speak, it's not true. But now it's like we've kind of let that title go and now it's like we're actually in the experience of the peace, letting the scaffolding go. But if that devotion is there and if that desire is there for that healing of the mind, you will get everything you need. Everything you need will be given. It's the split desire in the mind of wanting a little bit of this and a little bit of that that keeps you getting kind of a watered down version, so to speak, or no version actually of the truth. So it's little by little, but it's like you will get everything. When that mind is made up, the universe supports the yes to awakening. And that's what I found, is that I had a split desire of a little bit of the world and spirit as well. And it was like I finally got to see that my mind had to be single. It had to be single-pointed focus. And when that happened, of course, I didn't pop right into single-mindedness, but it was like everything that wasn't that started to be laid down very diligently, you know. So you'll get everything you want. Yeah, it's beautiful.
Question over there, Carolyn.
I think it's kind of funny because when I really deeply asked, and not for anything specific, just help me, 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 help me. And the first time I asked that, I got a free ride to the conference, and then David and Francis ended up at my house. I didn't ask for anything specific. And then the second time I said, same thing, help me, help me, help me, help me, help me. I just can't stand this, just help me. And then I get this call from Jason, who I didn't know, and he's like, hi, this is Jason. I never answer the phone from people I didn't know, but I just answered the phone. He's like, hi, this is Jason. And I'm like, okay. And he said, yeah, we're looking for this place. And I just said, yes, 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 yes. And there's Jason and Helena show up at my house. And then the third time, it was Jason and Jackie. But it's all from your group, okay? I mean, it could have been Earl Purdy, which, by the way, I sponsored to come to Chicago, and I didn't see him because something came up. Why did that happen? I don't know. But it's always this group. You know, the first thing that I was led to. When I know, but I feel like you, like this crazy woman with her hair sticking up and, you know, just like, ah, you know, and just so all just, you know, everywhere.
I guess so.
And that's sudden love, of course. And there's just such this magnetic attraction to this group. And I don't know why it's this group. I think somebody asked me, well, what is it about David? And I said, he's just so uncompromising. The whole group is so uncompromising. And I think that's, you know, that is the truth and the trust. And that's what I have always felt in my very deep core myself. And so, you know, I just cracked open the Course in Miracles, and then I did that for a year and a half, and then I discovered there's other people out there that are actually studying it. And I just felt like I was on my own, and then, like, David just popped up. David just showed up on something. I don't know if I got an email from, you know, like, signing up from something. I have no idea. And then there he was. And then it's like, all of you. You know, I just feel like I know you so intimately. And Nikita, I never met you personally, but I've heard so many things, and I just can feel you so strongly. And there was a time when David was sitting at my kitchen table, and I started to speak about Armel, and all of a sudden, I mean, how high she gets and lifted up. And, you know, this one thing that I was listening to her on Spreaker, and all of a sudden I just went way up there, and I didn't even remember what I was saying, where I was, who I was talking about anymore. And David had to remind me. And it's just this oneness with this group, and it makes me just, you know, I don't want to think about purpose or future or anything like that. I just want to just, you know, take it for what it is, and just, you know, keep accepting that love and that help from this group, whether you're in my home or not. And I really don't know what the next step is for me. So, but I know you guys are all like in my hearts, just truly in my hearts. No matter where you are, I just can't help but follow you. Francis, you're so sweet.
Thank you, because you know what this is right here? It's a witness, because, you know, Jason opened up talking about guidance, and we've talked a little bit about guidance. Sometimes people will say there is no such thing as guidance, or well, it's so hard to hear good guidance that it's kind of a watered-down word. Spirit guided me to buy that land, and Spirit guided me to marry you and divorce you, and guided. People are a little bit, ooh, they hear the guidance word, they're a little, oh. But, and it's the same, like, there was a friend, somebody was telling me, who lived in California for years and years, and she heard the word oneness so many times that she would get creepy when she would go out. I think Kirsten was at a gathering, and was a friend of Rogers, and she said, oh, I'm just so burned out on oneness.
It's overused.
Overused word.
In California,
and I think in some spiritual circles, its guidance is overused. But here's the witness. She just goes, help me, help me, help me, help me, help me, with everything in her heart. And how we get it is, I say to Francis, I think we should go to Carolyn's house. And then Jason hears, I think I'm going to call Carolyn. And they show up. And then Jack, you know, guidance is very practical. Sometimes people poo-poo and they say, well, I've heard a teacher say you can't actually hear guidance. If you work your whole life for 40, 50 years, you know, you're still not going to hear it. And even the Course says it's very difficult. You know, very few can hear the voice for God directly and everything. I never bought into all that stuff. To me, guidance was very, very helpful. If call it a practice or a symbol or a concept or whatever you want to call it, I hear it. I let it speak to me, through me, as me, you know, the whole deal. And the thing was so great with all of them is I think that's what we were drawn together with was that there's a practicality to it. And here you show up with help me, help me, help me, help me, and tell the rest of the story. And from our perspective, so to speak, is we hear, call Carolyn, go visit Carolyn. And we talk, you're going to Chicago? Oh, Carolyn. It comes in very directly. So it's not like this happenstance thing or this pie in the sky thing. That's what the witness is that it is actually very, very, very helpful. And the prayers are answered, and that's a beautiful witness. Just by you showing up, you've showed us that. You've been a witness to all of us.
Yeah, thank you. I mean, I wanted to go to a really fancy retreat in Santa Barbara with comfort and warmth and, you know, hot tubs, pools, and all that. But all the strawberries came into my life, strawberry gum, strawberry chapstick, strawberry Fields, Tic Tacs, you know, it was just, that's it. That was it. And there I was. Spirit works fast, and here I am. It was just amazing. I just love it. I didn't know how it worked on your end. I just help me, help me, help me, help me. I don't know how you got the message, but wow, it's just amazing. Yeah.
Well, there's a line in the course too that says, reach a point where miracles are natural. And I had that experience with you when you gave me those Strawberry Fields Tic Tacs. You're like, look, look. And I crack it open and take a few. You're like, no, look, Strawberry Fields. I'm like, oh, I know. I wanted the Tic Tacs. You know? So like, of course you were drawn here. It's like, it becomes so natural that this play together. So, yeah.
Yeah. Thank you. I love you guys very deeply.
We love you too, Carolyn.
I have a question I want to ask you, David, and I don't even really know what the question is that I want to ask, but I had a fantasy this morning of asking you a question. It was about a fantasy scenario.
That's good, because I had a fantasy of a black gospel piano revival. So we're helping each other out
might
here.
Might happen. Might happen.
Whoa.
Might happen this evening. I was imagining you in a room with Adolf Hitler. I was imagining you in a room with Adolf Hitler, and I just had the question, what would David say to Adolf Hitler? and where that comes from for me is, I think, not knowing how to be with people who evoke anything for me. I'm here with all these loving people and struggling with the masks and feeling unworthy. And if I were with Adolf Hitler, I mean, you know, I'd be out the door so fast. I don't know. And there's other parts of the question, too. I don't completely know what the question's about. But.
Yeah, I think that's been the greatest joy in my life is that this deep kind of inner connection with God has grown so strong and so immediate and so unshakable that actually I am used in those kind of ways where I will do like a long retreat and end up doing like 40 one-on-one sessions. And among those 40, there are those that come up and they look into my eyes, kind of they're fishing. Are you going to judge me for what I'm going to tell you now? Like, I'm going to unload my deepest, darkest, most disgraceful, disgusting, almost like they think subhuman things. And they kind of look into my eyes and then they unload. It's not so much what I say. And the same with Hitler or Mussolini or Osama bin Laden or, you know, on and on. Saddam Hussein, all
there's
these.
More to my question than that. I don't think I'm asking would you judge.
Yeah, what would
Hitler?
I say?
I think, would there be any impulse or any impetus to heal something? I mean, I'm imagining a scenario of Hitler there in the room saying, hey, David, I've got this plan to exterminate all the Jews. Let me tell you all about it. And
I've had that happen. I actually, she's saying with me, but no. She said some interesting things. I actually tell the parable. I mean, I've had so many interesting parables, but I remember one time I went to Chicago. Speaking of Chicago, I went to Chicago, and this woman came to one of my gatherings. I was hopping all around Chicago, and then she came and she said, "Would you come to my house to speak and share a gathering?" And so I said, sure. And so I went there, and the gathering wasn't in her house. The gathering was in a real estate office, her husband's real estate office, during business hours. And her husband was in there, and she said, oh, he's not into any of this at all. And I go in there, and all these people come in, and I just let whatever love was flowing. There's lots of love and joy and everything. And he was at his computer working, and then he sat there at his computer working during the whole gathering. People were hugging and kissing and joyfully going on. And finally, the whole place emptied out, so I was the only one left. And so I was in there, and I just went right up and sat across from him, just because I feel loving towards everyone. And he was in there. And so I went up to him, and my assistant at the time, remember Kathy, mm-hmm. Kathy Martin, she had gone in to talk to his wife, and they were in doing some dishes and just chatting and everything for a couple hours, I think, over a couple hours. And finally, they're in the middle of doing the dishes, and his wife turned to Kathy and said, "Where's David?" And Kathy said, "Oh, he's out in the office with your husband." And the woman was kind of shocked. She said, "Oh, my God, that's terrible. David and my husband have absolutely nothing in common." And as I was out there and as I sat down with him and everything, he felt very comfortable and relaxed. And he started off with that whatever happened in this office was the most pathetic thing I've ever seen. A bunch of people coming in, pretending they're happy, reading this stupid blue book. You think they're going to get something out of a blue book? And that just started it all. Then he went on into which races he hated, who should be exterminated from the planet. It just absolutely opened up. And that's the funny thing, because his wife was saying, "Where's David?" Because I was out there for hours with this man, because in this state of presence, you see everyone exactly like yourself, regardless of the words that are spoken. Hitler would be no different. This guy had some very choice words for who should be exterminated, and I mean, really, really, really. But the best part was too. In fact, his wife said, "Well, sometimes when we go out, our friends have a nickname for us, Edith and Archie." So here is a scenario of being out for hours with Archie Bunker. But I didn't see it that way. And you know what? Since everything's a reflection of my mind, after this went on for hours, I said, what are some of the things that you're really interested in?" And he said, "Oh, I do impressions." And his little inner child, I stayed there seeing the Christ in him firm and clear, because it was the only thing in my mind. And after a while, he said, "I do impressions. Would you like to hear?" And then this guy started doing Jimmy Stewart. This is probably what Hitler would do for me, too. He would just relax so much in my presence that we would go, "Are we good? We good?" You know, we got to the point where he relaxed so much, he started doing impressions, Jimmy Stewart, James Cagney. He said, my son's doing impressions, too. You want to hear? I'll play him from them. I've got a website." And he turned his computer around, and he started... just the love started pouring through him. I had found the portal, and he started, his little inner child of joy started coming through after hours. It happened. And then he said, here was the one that was seemingly so opinionated, all these who should be exterminated and who was terrible and this and this. He looks at me with a little twinkle, childlike twinkle in his eye after he's been with me for a few hours. And he said, "Well, I don't know. I don't know." I've never heard Archie Bunker say, "I don't know." See, he's reflecting my mind. It has to be so. It has to be so. Everything, Hitler, everyone's a reflection of what's going on in consciousness. He said, "Well, I don't know. Maybe there is some kind of universal intelligence behind all of this cosmos." And I went, "Oh, my God, here we go. Archie Bunker speaks the truth." And it happened. And so I just share that parable a lot because, you know, that's why Jesus told us not to judge, because it lets us experience the love that we are and that everyone is. And whenever we have an opinion or a judgment, or we even interpret their words, anything, it's really blocking the light that we are, that everyone is. The love that we all are. And so those things, when you talk about them, those are real practical things for me. That's what it's been like for me and my shining the light all over in 32 countries on planet Earth. I come across those things. And we've had some things. I guess you could almost call them like exorcisms.
Yeah. I just want to, yeah, actually, that's the gift that, like, that's been my gift. That's exactly that there's been so much, like, direct and uncompromising love that it's like naturally everything that doesn't, something within just relaxes so deeply that you don't even notice, but it's like everything just, like, you know, comes up to your awareness, like, even, like, everything. It could be, the recent example, because I was joining with Jenny very closely, she was given, and I kept saying, Jenny, she's like, I'm like a baby here, and now it's Jenny's turn to babysit me. That's what it felt like. And
baby Nikita.
Right, it's like every, so, and so I was given to Jenny to babysit, and in the way I really felt like it, and at some point I really started to notice that I swear a lot, like, I was just like, this language will come out, I was just like, I just really started to notice that I would, it was just something else, it was just some kind of, and not a Jenny, not just in general, just the language, I would talk, and it was just like intense, some kind of like, waves, there was just like these waves, and then almost, but to the point where it took me a while to really notice it. I just started to notice there's something, but complete emptiness that's happening. And then I prayed about it, and then I started crying because I was, like, in such gratitude. And what I felt was there's such deep love, unconditional love. It's just, like, nothing but Christ. It's, like, I can feel it's, like, Jenny's joining with me, and she says she sees nothing but Christ. And so naturally there's just trust, and something just opens up, and then there's, like, everything is allowed, and it's, like, let it all go, like, no need to hold together anything, no, even little threads of the mask concept, let it all go, and I was crying, because I'm, like, I can breathe, like, the experience of it is, like, I can, on the very deep level, I can breathe much deeper, and I knew, like, it's not gonna last, but it's just that experience, and then, like, every time, like, let's say Jenny and I would go for a ride or somewhere, and I would, like, you know, whatever, it will be like a whole, I don't know, scenario, and we'll come back, and Jenny would, she would always giggle and laugh and be like, oh my God, no one talks like you do, you know, and then in the end, my experience would be like, you love me so much, and that's, like, that's the spirit, is just, like, allowing to be loved like that, because the love is so direct, and it's, that's the gift, and it's so, yeah, so it's, yeah, I'm sure, that's why I'm like, oh yeah, for sure that would happen with Hitler. If David met Hitler, there's no, this would be it, that he would just relax so much and so deeply, he'd be like, probably jumping around like a kid, doing funny skits or something, you know, like, there's, that's for sure, that would be the only scenario, I vouch for it, I know, so, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, you just have to listen to the parables. They're all online, and of these adventures over the last 25 years. It's not of this world, and yet the more you tune into it, you feel it. You go, wow, that's in me. I've got that capacity for love. I could face anything. I could face anyone. I could transcend it. The things that the world thinks are so big, you know, these terrorists and this and that. That's nothing. That's nothing. I have healed the world, you know. I have healed the entire world through Christ in me, you know, through God's love. And that's, it really is impelling, you know. I think when you think about Gandhi's life or some of the greats, you know, people love being around him. It was exciting to be around that presence because it undoes the world. That certainly sent reverberations. And even Gandhi, when I read his autobiography, you know, he hated being called Mahatma, great soul, because he still was very aware of what was still coming up in him. So he couldn't stand having hundreds of thousands of people calling him great soul. Please, no, no, no. Because he also lived in India where there was the, you know, the Ramana Maharshis, the Yoganandas and so forth that were amazing reflections of this unified spirit, and he felt a little modest, actually. No, please, not the Mahatma label. You know, you don't know. But it was, he revealed all that in his autobiography, so this is a very high calling.
Yeah, what's being undone is the belief in an external world. And like the more we come into this presence of knowing who I am, yeah, the belief that there is an external authority is getting washed, and that there's really external teachers outside of my mind, or external successes or external failures, or and then the encounters just become like a unified experience of self, communicating with self. And even like encounters with police, you know, they're not what they once were. Like an encounter one time, I was in a car with friends, and the driver ran through a red light in the front car, and then the driver in my car ran through a very red light in Florida at midnight after we'd had a spiritual gathering. And this cop, you know, Florida cop, big guy, comes walking up to the car. And we were in such a presence of love that I'm like, oh, here comes a holy encounter. And we were just about to run out of gas. Like the car was running out of petrol and we didn't know where the gas station was. And so something in me knew, like, this is the help that we're actually asking for. So he comes up to the car, you know, all like serious, and starts to talk about the, you know, running the red light and what do you think you're doing. And I just looked at him and I said, you're an angel. And he kind of did this double take and he said, hang on a minute, let me just do my cop role. I just need to say what I need to say, and then we can see what's happening here. And he said, so you did run a red light and it's Florida. And he, you know, he was kind of stuttering a bit because he couldn't remember his mask. And the driver was so funny, because she was a bit scared. She had a bit of guilt that she'd run through a very red light. So she said to him, they're spiritual teachers. They're not normal people. And we just had this beautiful encounter. And I swear it was like he was my little brother. I have this younger brother in New Zealand, and he's much taller than me. And, you know, he's this big kind of he has this presence where he's, yeah, like the protector, the loyal protector. And I just looked at him and felt such love. Like, I know who you are. And he said, okay, girls, what do you need? And we said, well, we're just about to run out of gas. Do you know where the nearest gas station is? And he said, yeah, follow me. He put his lights on. And he led us, you know, past a couple of closed gas stations around to one that was open. And that's it. Like, that's what life becomes about. It's like the veil of separation disappears when the fear disappears. And you see that truly there is no one and nothing that's really outside of my mind. It's that was an attack thought. And so the experience of that external world was full of attack and full of defense and protectionism, as if there really was someone or something else out there that had a different purpose to me and was not here to support and didn't understand me, didn't really know who I truly am. And as that has just been washed through forgiveness, I know who I am, and therefore I see, you know, who it is in front of me. And just that awareness calls it forth. And any veil that still seems to be there is so thin, and it just drops, you know.
Oh, yeah, let's go eat. No.
Oh,
all right.
Thank you.
So I just wanted to kind of echo what's being said from the point of view of somebody who's never been to any of your stuff, read any of your books. You know, I basically just met y'all a couple weeks ago. But, I mean, this exquisite experience has been happening of whatever I've needed has been right there. who, a couple of days ago, I said a prayer about, you know, help me let go of whatever's in the way of being with you all the time. And then all this stuff came up. And I was like, what's the, you know, I forgot that I said that prayer. And, and anyway, the good news is what happened was right in the middle of having all these feelings that I haven't had for a long time and letting go of some real old script stuff, I realized, oh, this is my movie. Of course these people are being control freaks because I'm a non-control. You know, it's like I have authority issues. So no wonder, you know, it was like I woke up and realized I asked for this movie right now. And so here it is. Anyway, so that's one thing that's happening. The other thing that's happening is, you know, I've never... I've never seen so much authentic love, you know? Like people that don't even know me have been coming up to me and holding me. And it's just, I don't know, it's, I feel like I'm home, you know? And it's, and when Suzanne was sharing, you know, it's like 17 years ago is when I joined the community I moved to Arizona to be with. And none of the expectations that we all had came to fruition, but of course it's all, you know, perfect. And I just really respect what you all have done and wanted to give credit to everybody. You know, it's not just there's no levels. Like for a while I'm thinking, well, I don't know about this, there's like seem to be these levels and these different categories, but really the people who organized the event have been just as conscious as anybody is, you know. So anyway, it's just been a really great experience.
On the guidance, in case anybody's tight about not hearing that guidance voice, because I don't hear it, but I watched the video and I heard Dave say he uses it like the I Ching. So I grabbed a book and sitting in bed. I said, okay, what do you want me to know? Open it up and there's the coaster from the you know, the tour of Strawberry Fields.
And here you are. That's great. That was direct. That was very specific, too. Boom.
Simple.
Okay, well, I think it's time to move towards lunch now, and this has been so much fun. We haven't done this. This was kind of fun. We've never done this. Sometimes we have a smaller group in Australia or here or there, but this is... We did in China. We had maybe five or six people there in China. That was a lot of fun too. But so yeah, maybe we'll do this again sometime. Yeah, I'll speak at 3 o'clock, and then tonight
I sing at 7.
Yes, there's open mic at 7, and a dance party right down here tonight. So get ready. We love you.